because we're not a scholars organization.
That's right. Come on.
We're scholar warriors, and our whole community is a part of our organization. And the purpose and design of our organization is to arm us for this enormous warfare that we've been engaged in. One of our great leaders and scholars, our founding president, Dr. Jacob Carruthers, has written a book, Intellectual Warfare, in which he summarized some of his great writings. You are in the midst of a struggle for the African mind, the African heart, and the African spirit. And that battle can only be won if we make an uncommitted and undying commitment to be as African as we can, to move on a path of Africanness that will allow us to strengthen ourselves. Knowledge is power. So clearly, African knowledge is African empowerment. But we're not alone on this planet. There are others on the planet who have systemized the destruction of African peoples. And so our war is not a war that's going to happen in a day. It's a war that's part of our eternal struggle to restore Africanness. And that eternal struggle to restore Africanness is on what I refer to, and all my partners in this warfare describe, as a victorious African path. If you want to hang on to Negroness, the victory is questionable. If you want to think that you're a black, white man or woman, you've already defeated yourself. But if you tap into Africanness, the victory is at hand. Why is it at hand? Because there's an explosion of information that has allowed us to empower ourselves in ways that were not conceivable years ago. For me and the other scholars I've worked with over these years, we're in what I call the Great Awakening, the period at which this knowledge is coming together, exploding, in fact, in front of us, and we're now trying to systematize it and allow it to be part of our renewal, our renovation. This is key and crucial for us to understand that this knowledge has to be systematized so that we can control what we saw here on this stage today. Control of the African socialization process from before the womb till after the tomb. If we don't continually work with these youngsters day and night, they'll be lost to us. The system of domination, destruction, and death that we have been doing battle with is night and day planning the control, the manipulation, and the subjugation of African peoples. And so education is key. Education is key. But the question is, do you want an education of dependency or an education of liberation? An education that enhances the Africanness, or an education that denies it and marginalizes it or wipes it out completely? So Philadelphia is to be congratulated. Let's give Philadelphia a hand, another hand, for having taken this bold step. But Philadelphia is taking this bold step because the thrust that we made forward in the 50s and the 60s, certainly, and into the 70s, was pushed back by the reaction of the system of domination, destruction, and death in the 80s and the 90s. So that's why we have to come forth again with that same force that we had in the 60s that allowed us to step forth and demand what we need. I was proud to be a part of the student at City College. I was a professor, but to be a part of the students at City College that demanded in 1969 in New York that they open up the system to our people. And not only that, admit them, but admit them from the poorest of the schools, because the educational system had been structured into two tiers, a success tier of elite schools and a failing tier for the general population. And our children were left out of the success pattern. We realized that, students studied it, and they demanded that the university open up, and they did. They demanded that they put in place advisors and counselors to help them. They did. They demanded that they put remedial processes in place so they can make up for inadequacies. They did. They demanded that they set up faculty and schools and departments that dealt with the experience of African peoples, Asian peoples, Latin American peoples, and they did. And as a result, when I was at City College in 1969, teaching in the political science, 60 students, they were represent almost 20% of the full-time black student population at the college. Within a few years, there were thousands of blacks in the college. Within a few years, we were able to structure the largest black studies program in the world. 80 courses on the books, 50 to 60 taught every year. Larger than political science, history, economics, anthropology, sociology. 22 faculty members, 15 of them tenured or permanent employment. 3 visiting professors. At one time, John Jackson was a visiting professor. Dr. Akinjobin from Nigeria was a visiting professor. And Bill Riviere from the Caribbean was a visiting professor. It's unheard of for that to happen. It was only done because of the power of our people demanding access to the educational system. If you lose this ability to demand, you will not receive what you're supposed to. Power is the ability to define reality and have other people respond to your definition as if it were their own. And that's what those youngsters did. Not only in City College, but they also did the same thing in San Jose, where I set up the Black Studies Department at San Jose. Power conceives nothing without a demand. It never did, it never will. We have to mobilize, organize ourselves to be a very powerful force to break down this system of white supremacy. But at the same time that you're breaking down the system of white supremacy, you gotta have the ability and the capacity and the understanding and the analysis to put in place a system of your own. It is not enough to destroy that which is oppressing you. You have to have the foresight to plan at the same time that which is necessary for your development and build for eternity.